At the outset, I'm not a pessimist, but at the outset, I would like a question from all of you. Would you like to be jobless within coming 10 years? I know this is a self-leading question, self-answering question. Everyone will answer no. First, see this quotation, this famous quote by Curtis Langlois, and you will understand why I have asked this question. First, read this quotation. Okay. So the message is crystal clear. Either you have to learn artificial intelligence or be ready to be isolated and languish in oblivion. So first thing first, we have to learn artificial intelligence, but not like a computer engineer. We will have to know just basic terms of artificial intelligence. If you want to learn a language, what you have to do? First of all, you'd like to know its basic terms. Whenever you encounter a computer engineer, they will use certain common terms like algorithm, and we are having a blank face. So don't continue with a blank face. Algorithm is nothing but is a step by step instructions to accomplish a goal. And data labeling is nothing but it is process of attaching meaning to different types of digital data. But these are the two terms are very common terms used in computer science in general. We are basically concerned with the words and terms used in artificial intelligence, especially in radio diagnosis. So what about artificial intelligence itself? It is nothing. It is just simulation of human intelligence in machine. अगर आपको किसी बच्चे को ट्रेंड करनी हो कि उसको नॉलेजेबल बनाना है, what do you do? You just teach him, just let him to learn by experience. So machines are nothing but just like kids. They need to be taught, or they are put in an environment to learn themselves by experience. Artificial intelligence is nothing. It is just programming to perform intelligent tasks like humans. I am going to discuss few of the common AI terms used in radiology and other branches. Before discussing these terms, I have classified these terms in two groups. Those highlighted in violet color are terms used in radiology, and those highlighted in brick color are general terms used in the field of artificial intelligence. Have a look up on the screen. I'm going to the next slide. First, I'm going to discuss what are the most common applications of artificial intelligence. I'm going to describe the terms that were highlighted as brick red. Natural language processing. What is NLP? You know that language of computer is different from ourselves. We use languages like Hindi or English, but it is not language of computers. Computer use languages like Java, C++, etc. So if you want to deal with a computer, if there is some interaction between a human and computer, there must be some application that converts our language to that of computers. And this application is called natural language processing. What about vision? I have just told that artificial intelligence is nothing but to make machines like a human. So as a human, we are having vision, we are having thinking capability, we are having capability to take decisions. So computer should also have a vision, and it is everywhere. You are using vision application of artificial intelligence in everyday life. You know QR code scanners, you know Facebook recognitions of faces. Then what about speech? You say something like, okay, Google, and the artificial intelligence recognizes it. So these are the common application. And what about robotics? It's nothing. When the mechanical element is added to artificial intelligence, it comes under the science of robotics. Samta, my sound is clear. I am well audible now.
Yes, sir, very well.
Okay. So these are the terms under heading of radiology, terms used in the field of terms of artificial intelligence used in the field of radiology. It is a very vast topic, but I have tried to simplify it by sub-categorizing these words in three broad categories, that is expert system, image recognition, and machine learning. And the main area of interest is machine learning. In the coming slides, you will encounter few of the terms which are not very friendly with doctors because you have never heard it. But I would like to simplify these terms by giving some examples. First, expert system. What is the expert system? It is that branch of artificial intelligence that makes a machine to behave like a specialist, like a radiologist. So there are certain common expert systems used in artificial intelligence. One common example is MySyn. What is MySyn? As I remember, it was one of the earliest applications of artificial intelligence in medical science. MySyn is nothing, but it is a software that identifies bacteria and recommends a specific antibiotics for them. It was developed by Stanford University in early 70s. Then DxPlain, what is DxPlain? You all know that DX stands for diagnosis. So DxPlain software helps a physician to come to a particular diagnosis. You simply feed clinical symptoms and all the pathological data, etc., in the system, and the system will give you particular a set of differential diagnosis, making your task easy. Then PXDES. PXDES is nothing. DES stands for Diagnostic Expert System, or PX stands for Pneumoconiosis X-ray Diagnostic Expert System. So PXDES is that application of artificial intelligence which helps us to read a chest X-ray, to study lung disease. And CADET by itself, it is nothing but cancer. It is CADET stands for cancer detection. That part of artificial intelligence which helps us to reach the diagnosis of cancer is called CADET. Obviously, apart from PXDES, these other three expert systems are used in general medicine and oncology, and we are more concerned with PXDES. Then vision or image recognition. Now, I think everyone who is using ultrasound is well aware that whenever our system encounters an image like fetal head, it automatically recognizes it. And it gives the desired measurements like BPD and head circumference. So that is a function of vision of the artificial intelligence. Here I would like to discuss a topic that is a bit off the track. All of you know about PCPNDT Act. What is basic motive of PCPNDT Act? It has been meant to differ from sex determination because society is concerned about falling child sex ratio. They are trying that there should not be sex determination at ultrasound centers, and which may lead to abortion of female child. I have only one question to all of you. If our system can recognize head, if our system can recognize humerus, obviously our system can recognize fetal genitalia. That is obvious. And if it can recognize fetal genitalia, it can also blur it. That is possible because for artificial system, an image is nothing but its number. A number can be added or it can be subtracted. So if the system can identify fetal genitalia, it can be made blurred in every system. And the whole problem of PCPNDT Act can be solved. No cumbersome form F filling, no court cases, no raids, no problem for the radiologists and also for the government. So I will request everyone, every representative of different companies who is attending this seminar, to apply for patent for a software that will blur fetal genitalia in system, so that the basic problem of sex determination will be gone and no paperwork will be needed. I think there will be some practical problems like child with ambiguous genitalia may be born, but for doing any big task, you have to sacrifice few things, and that will be true for this application. Anyway, I was just exploring one of the possible usage of artificial intelligence. I would like to love to have comments from you on this issue. Then machine learning. This is the most important topic. As the name applies, what is machine learning? It is science of getting computers to learn and act like humans. So the science of making the machine like humans, to make them capable of doing cognitive functions. And what about deep machine learning? When we apply a particular thing, when we apply artificial neural network to machine learning, it is called deep machine learning. And what is artificial neural network? It must not be very difficult for you to understand. Why? You know that as a humans, we are having natural intelligence. And how do we get this natural intelligence? We get it by our nervous system. We have sensory system, we have motor system, and we have brain. Just like that, engineers have developed a system which consists of neural network where the data is processed. And that is called deep machine learning. And these deep machine learnings are basically of two types. One is called CNN and second is called RNN. What is CNN? CNN nothing. It is convolutional neural network or CONNET. It is a type of artificial neural network characterized by regularized version of multi-layer perception. At beginning, this may seem a bit difficult to you, but I think it is not so. Just think of the normal natural intelligence of human being. What is happening here? We have an input as sensory system. We see something, okay? Now this signal goes through the sensory nerve to our brain. There it is processed. That is very complex. That is very complex. And now at the end, we get the things done through the motor system. Because the brain is very complex and consists of a large volume of gray matter, it needs to be convoluted. All of you know that our brain surface is not smooth. It is convoluted. Why? Because the brain had to adjust a large volume of gray matter within a closed hard cranial cavity. Just like that, in convolutional neural network, the computer engineer has to adjust a data in a very limited space. And these data are called, these processing layers are called hidden layers. So that is called convolutional neural networks. And the next network is RNN, recurrent neural network. As the name suggests, is it recurrent? Here it is like a cycle. There is an input, then there are hidden layers for processing, and after that there is output. But this output is again used as input for the next layer. So it is a continuous process. It is a subtype of artificial neural network that involves directed cycles in memory. Remember it, it involves directed cycle in memory. What are the basic differences between CNN and RNN? You don't need to know these things in details because you are not concerned with application. So CNN, what you basically need to know that CNN is basically suitable for spatial data, data in space, while RNN is basically suitable for temporal data. The CNN uses minimal amount of pre-processing, but the RNN uses their internal memory to process the input. CNN is ideal for images. RNN is ideal for text and speech analysis. It considers the current input, while the RNN considers the current input plus previously received input. So it is used for CNN, used for image data, while RNN is used for sequential data. There is a question, which one will be better for a video processing? The answer is obvious, because what is video? It is nothing but it is sequential data of images. Therefore, RNN are used for processing videos. I think it is clear, CNN versus RNN. Then supervised, unsupervised, and reinforced learning. It is very easy to understand by its very name, by its very title. What is supervised learning? I have just told you that machines are like kids. They are rather mischievous kids. One of the problem with artificial intelligence is that they will never accept that they don't know these things. I will show you some of the examples later on this presentation. If you ask artificial intelligence, what is sugar? And it doesn't know what is sugar. But they will not tell, it will not tell you that he doesn't know what is sugar. Rather, he will counter question you, what is taste of sugar? And obviously, he will tell sweet. It goes into its memory. It is just a label data. It goes into its memory. And in this way, he gets answer from lakhs and crores of persons. And every answer is included in its memory. And the artificial intelligence such becomes manifold intelligent than a human being. What is supervised learning? When the machine is trained like a student with level data. Level data I've already discussed. Suppose you have to train a machine to read X-rays. What you will do? You will do first, you will feed it with labeled X-rays that this is heart, this is mediastinum, this is ribs. And when it gets a large volume of labeled data, it will be able to diagnose certain diseases. If there are labeled diseases in its memory, like lung cancer or pneumonia or pleural effusion, it will be able to identify it. That is called supervised learning. Then unsupervised learning. Here we leave the machine to let him learn by itself. It simply recognizes different similarities, patterns, and differences in the environment and learns by itself by experience. And third one is reinforced learning. Here, we don't teach the machine and we don't leave it with certain patterns. The machine simply learns by trial and error. Learn on the, please read it on the slide. Okay, so it learns by trial and error method. That is called reinforcement learning. This is a pictorial representation of supervised, unsupervised, and reinforcement learning. The supervised learning is complaining that humans give so much to read and test because we give the machine a large data, a large level data it has to read. And the unsupervised learning is complaining that at least they are giving you the answers, but here I get nothing. I have to learn by recognizing patterns, etc. But reinforcement learning is happy. He tells, don't worry, I know how to outplay them. I think all these three terms are now clear to you. Protocol of my presentation is on the screen. I have already discussed the first three headings. Now I am going to discuss in short what is the use of artificial intelligence in radiology and in ultrasound. Basically, the artificial intelligence is being used in radiology in CT scan and MRI. Till there, these are the most important fields. The field of neuroradiology is most important for application of artificial intelligence. But now it is banging the doors of ultrasound too. And very soon we will have a large number of applications in ultrasound machines. If I have to discuss usage of artificial intelligence in radiology in two words, I will tell it saves time. the basic benefits from the artificial intelligence, it saves time because you can do so many things. I have written it in linear fashion. Read the 7 lines below. There are other users too. They have got remarkable image recognition task, even better than humans. They can make MRI scan 10 times faster, and they can fill up missing information with calculation. This is very important. If you have missed something, they can fill this gap. I will show it to you in coming slides. They can create optimum hanging protocol. I think you know what is hanging protocol, because now there are large number of images, and to arrange them in a particular sequence is a cumbersome task, but it can be done by help of software with artificial intelligence. They can do automated scoring. They can do automated computer-aided reporting. And they can also do certain administrative type like planning patient schedule. But in this presentation, we are not discussing applications of AI in radiology. Rather, we have to focus upon applications of AI in ultrasound. I am coming to that topic. What are the usage of, what are the applications of artificial intelligence in ultrasound? First, using single 2D images as input, artificial intelligence can use data to create images in multiple planes, in 3-dimensional plane. That is called a smart detection. They can auto calculate many things like BPD, HC, etc., just saving time. That is called a smart calculations. Then subtraction images. I have just told, discuss about it. What is subtraction image? I have told that for computers, images are nothing but numbers. They can add or subtract it. Then AI assisted visualizations of hidden area, a smart visualization, and image recognition and characterization. This is very important. It's being for detection of cancer, detection of images, and to differentiate them as benign or malignant condition. Then image optimization. If your image is blurred, only one touch can improve your image quality. Then miscellaneous usage, like because they can automatically calculate intracerebral volume if you provide them with images, they can calculate intracerebral volume, auto calculations in echo like ejection fraction, or left ventricular function can be calculated just with a click. And it is very important in IV fluid management. I am going to discuss a smart detection. Basically, there are two areas, that is fetal heart planes and fetal CNS planes, where it is being applied on a wider scale. All of you know about these 4 standard planes of fetal brain, that the transcerebellar, transthalamic, transventricular planes, and mid-sagittal plane. If you want to get these images applying artificial intelligence, you have to follow certain norms. First is that recommended gestational age should be between 20 to 30 weeks, because if the head is too large or too small, AI cannot display these structures. Second, the brain midline angle relative to the horizontal plane should be less than 40 degrees. It should not be too much tilted. Then size of ROI should be large enough to include the cranial region only. Before 3D acquisition, you must be assured that there is no acoustic shadow in the scanning plane. This is an example. Step 1 here, first acquire 3D fetal. The first acquire a transcerebral view and use a smart button to acquire 3D data set. Press the smart plane tab to touch on the touch panel. Then press the auto measure button on the touch panel and the system will automatically measure these 6 important calculations. Next is the video how it is done, just to display how it is done. This is transferable airplane. Now the machine automatically calculates and gives the 4 planes, 4 important planes. And after that, just touch the calculate, auto calculate button and you will get all the important calculations. Now there is an image that transferable airplane. Now we have used a smart button to acquire 3D data set and the machine gives automatically gives all the 4 required planes, 4 important CNS planes. And it not only gives the 4 important CNS planes, but it also calculates this automatically. But there is one important point in this presentation. I'm just going back to that image. Here in this basic image, any experienced sonologist or radiologist will tell that it is of suboptimal quality. We cannot see this cerebellar hemisphere here, but see what artificial intelligence has done to it. In this image, you can see both cerebellar hemispheres nicely. So this AI has compensated the suboptimal image quality by calculating and by adding. This is one of the very important use of artificial intelligence, that it can fulfill missing informations. Now, fetal heart evaluation by artificial intelligence. You all know how the fetal heart, what should be the ideal 4-chamber view. It should be between 45, the angle should be between 25 to 60 feet, etc. And cardiac apex should point towards that. Then the next step is that ROI size should be optimum. It should not be very large or very small. That is applicable everywhere when you are trying to get data from AI. Step one is acquire 3D fetal heart data set from 4-chamber view. Step two is press the S planes FH button. Step three, press the navigate button. These steps are unique for minor Regiona 7 system, but in every system from every vendor, you will have similar types of steps. Only name will change. And step four is move the trackball and mark the crux point in the 4-chamber view here, where crux you know very well. And the system will detect and display 6 standard planes automatically. Here is the example. I know today fetal echocardiography is a hot cake and it is very cumbersome to, at least for a beginner, I am not telling everybody, I know there are very knowledgeable and very experienced radiologists in this field, but for the beginner, it becomes very cumbersome to acquire all these 6 images. But with the help of artificial intelligence, such applications, if you are having, getting a very good quality 4C view, you can easily get all these 6 important views within seconds. What are the benefits of a smart planes? It saves, whether it is CNS or it is fetal echo. It saves time, that is very important. It is intelligent, it reduces operator dependence. It enhances diagnostic confidence and it is accurate. There are other AI-assisted auto calculations. A smart OB, automatic volume calculation, a smart NT, a smart pelvis, a smart follicle. Few of these applications like a smart NT and a smart OB are not a newcomer. All of you are using these things, but a smart pelvic and a smart follicle are relatively new thing. What is smart OB? Nothing, just acquire an image, press the required biometric button and you will get the calculation. Like this. Then automatic volume calculation. This software automatically measures volume in 3D for any fluid-filled structures, whether it is urinary bladder or gallbladder or follicle. Different companies have given different names to this application. Here it is called a smart volume bladder. Just get image of urinary bladder in both planes, and the machine will automatically calculate volume of the urine. Then this is a smart NT. Just get an image as recommended by Fetal Medical Foundation, and the machine will automatically trace the NT and display its maximum thickness, saving of time. Then auto IMT for carotid Doppler, it may automatically calculate IMT for cardiovascular risk assessment. The smart pelvis is a bit newcomer, till date not used by most of us. Just take a mid-sagittal view of female pelvis. This application is used for pelvic floor dysfunction in female, which is a very common problem. Urinary incontinence is very common in a woman of particular age. So just take the mid-sagittal plane and press the auto-calculate button, and the system will give you all the required calculations like bladder neck descent or urethra tilt angle, etc., bladder symphysis distance. Then a smart FLC. The basal anterior follicular count test measures a woman's ovarian reserve. The ovarian reserve reflects her fertility potential and chances of success of IVF. It is very important, because if someone is going for ART for IVF, it is the treating doctor must know what are the possibility of success. For that, anterior follicular count is done on day 2, 3, and 5. And with help of these data, basal anterior follicular count plus age plus level of AMH and anti-mullerian hormone and follicular stimulating hormone on day 3, a good prediction of success of in vitro fertilization can be calculated, can be done. This is not 3 to 8 anterior follicle per ovary is considered normal. And if it is less than 5, there are less chances of pregnancy. And if it is more than 20, there is higher risk of ovarian hyperstimulation. So it is double-edged sword, and a smart FLC helps you. So the referring consultant may ask you to provide the number of anterior follicles, total ovarian volume, total follicular volume, mean follicular volume, volume of either the smallest and largest follicle. If you try to do these things in 2D ultrasound, it will be very cumbersome and time-taking. But with automated volume calculation, you will get the result within seconds. Automatically detects the number of follicles from volume data and automatic calculation of the volume of each follicle. And the machine also helps to arrange them in particular order, in order of size, and assigns particular color to them. So the referring consultant gets a visual impression of the report like this. This system, a smart FLC, accurate assessment of the size of follicle. Follicles are automatically sorted by sizes with color codes, and each easy reporting with colorful graphic designs for follicular study. So it will be very helpful. Then subtraction images. I have already told you that system can subtract or add some images, because for system, for computer, is nothing but a number. Here is an example. This is a 16-year-old girl that was diagnosed at RPOC. She was non-married. She was diagnosed at RPOC at some peripheral area. But you can see that there is a echogenic collection. There is also something, a heterogeneous area, basically echogenic area here. And in a color doctor, it is highly vascular. So you can understand that is nothing but it is a case of ABM, uterine ABM. This is power Doppler. Subtraction angiography can help you to subtract all the background images, and you all know benefits of subtraction angiogram because you are using it in higher modalities. The vascular pattern can give you a hint about whether the lesion is malignant or benign. So now it is possible in ultrasound too to have a subtraction angiogram. For example, I have given subtraction angiogram of a lymph node. So you can tell that is nothing but an acute inflammatory nodes. because there is large number of vessel, but they are regular, no new angiogenesis in. Then AI assisted smart visualization. A smart face is a very common example. You are all convergent with this thing. 3D acquisition of fetal face. But sometimes the image is not so clear because it is hidden by fetal hand or umbilical cord. In such conditions, you can use a smart face application. Here you can see that the baby face is hidden by its hand, but this hand has been subtracted by the system, by the artificial intelligence, and you can see the whole face. Then optimization of images, it is very common application. By just touching one of the keys, you can optimize your image, making it more clear. Here I have given an example of a stereoscope used in Resona 7. Just by touching, by using stereoscope, you can get a clearer image. Then a smart breast is nothing. I have just told you that image recognition and characterization AI is very, have developed very much, even surpassing humans in detection and recognition of images. So in a smart breast, in this example, in this citation, the image has not only detected the lesion, but also characterized it. It has given all the relevant information regarding whether it is regular, what is its shape, what is the orientation, what is its margin, echo pattern, etc. And based on this data, it is also assigned, it's a BI-RADS scoring. It is 4B. It is a smart breast case of a invasive carcinoma. So it will be very helpful. There are other miscellaneous uses like intracerebral volume calculation, auto calculation of B line numbers, percentage and distance of fibrillation of lung content, then auto calculation of ejection fraction LVF in echocardiography, and auto calculation of velocity, time integral, cardiac output and the stroke volume variation in ICU for IV fluid management. We are not very much concerned with LVF and ejection fraction and management, IV fluid management, because they are basically tasks of cardiologist and also doctors working in ICU. No doubt some of the radiologists are also doing these things. So this is an example of intracerebral volume calculation. You can diagnose microcephaly and microcephaly. I am not doing these things. I have just got these images from MindRay. This is a smart B-line. You all know that B-line represents fluid content of the lungs. They are artifacts traversing the lung parenchyma. So a smart B-line will automatically calculate B-line number, percentage, and distance. It provides unique visual scoring map for intuitive overall lung water evaluation, guiding the fluid infusion and preventing pulmonary edema. So it is very useful. Now the burning question. If artificial intelligence can do so many things, is it going to be a threat for us? It is boon or bane? Will it replace us? I've heard that many of the radiologists are planning, young radiologists are planning to change their profession due to threat by artificial intelligence. But this is an ultra radical step. I don't think that is going to happen in near future. This is a publication which tells that artificial intelligence will automatically track acquired images in anomaly scan. It will not only track images in anomaly scan, but it will also assess its quality, replacing a human peer reviewer. So it is also going to keep an eye upon you, the quality of work, to assess quality of a work. And your employer can see what is your level of working, how much skill you are in doing your task. So definitely it is a threat, but to what extent? Researchers have developed deep learning neural network that can identify pathologies in radiological images, in some cases more reliably than an average radiologist. Mark this language, mark this one. It can, in some cases, it can diagnose pathology more reliably than an average radiologist. Deep learning is rapidly advancing. Every day there are new applications, new things happening. So some medical students have reportedly decided not to specialize in radiology simply because they fear the job will cease to exist. Before coming to my opinion, I will like to discuss what AI can do and what AI cannot do. Examples of artificial intelligence around us. All of you are well versed with chatbots like Google Assistant, Alexa, Siri, etc. They are used in self-driving cars. They are used in ride-sharing apps by Ubers. They are used as autopilots. AI, like a human, can read, write, see, hear, and understand. And it is told that in future, it is likely to do extraordinary tasks like reading a person's mind. But there are certain limitations. We are most interested in what artificial intelligence cannot do. What it cannot do, this is most important. AI cannot be innovative. They will do what they are taught to do. They lack emotions, empathy, moral values, and ethics because they are not humans. This is also very important. It becomes confused in complex environment. And that is one of the major limitations of artificial intelligence. I will cite an example. But first, this is a common quotation. This is a common perception that computers are basically idiot. Basically, they do nothing. They can only count 0 and 1. They know only 2 digits. The present conventional binary computer knows only 2 digits, 0 and 1. But they handle very large data with ultra-radical speed, and that is their beauty. But they are not innovative. Their output depends upon input. And in complex environment, AI may be confused. For example, the present scenario of lockdown in corona pandemic. In the present crisis of corona pandemic, artificial intelligence of big enterprises like Amazon, Facebook, it's are confused and cease to work properly and suddenly change human behavior and online shopping habits because everyone is shopping online for masks and sanitizers. So their artificial intelligence, which was giving suggestions, is practically becoming useless. They are now trying to do the required amendments. I am giving you a practical example how artificial intelligence becomes totally confused if its environment is completely, radically changed. This is, you can see, a section of liver. And it is a male patient. What I have done, I set the machine for obstetrical calculations and used 4 Duvalum volume probe. And I kept the ROE over the liver and tried to gather the information. What happened? The machine practically became confused. It tried to pick up lesions, pick up structures that were close to fetal brain. And like an idiot, it detected so many structures of fetal brain. That was a joke. And it did not only detected these structures, but it also calculated BPD like that, and OFD, and head circumference, etc. So that is limitation of artificial intelligence. They are basically, they can do what they have taught to do. Radiologists do more than read and interpret images. Like other AI system, radiology AI system performs single task. That is why it is called narrow AI. The deep learning models are trained for a specific image recognition task like nodule detection on chest CT or hemorrhage on brain MRI. Radiologists are humans. They do a lot more than image recognition. They have empathy, they have emotions, they have interaction with the patients. They know whether the patient is poor or rich. They examine the patient physically. They also consult with other physicians, perform image-guided medical interventions, and relate findings from image to other medical records. For deep learning machines, this is also important. Deep learning machines will need a large collection of level data. I have already told you what is level data. Further expanding the role of radiologists in the AI world. So this will be a new job opportunity. If companies have to develop a good quality AI for performing particular tasks, they need level data. And to get a radiological level data is not easy, like getting images of cars and trees. To get a radiological level data, they will have to take help from a hospital and radiologist. So this will be a new field of job creation. What is my take-home message? Artificial intelligence is playing a potential role for a quick and accurate diagnosis in the field of ultrasound, making our task easier with significant time saving. Will AI overtake radiologists in future is shrouded with uncertainty. Why I am telling that it is shrouded with uncertainty? Because what I have discussed about idiocy of the computers is concerned with our conventional computer, our binary computer. But what is going to happen? Now, other type of computing that is called quantum computing has been introduced in the system. And what quantum computing will do, it's very uncertain. Its capability are limitless, and perhaps it can do things beyond our expectations. So when it is introduced, when it becomes common, what will happen with radiologists, I cannot tell. But more likely, radiologists will continue to play the key role, and artificial intelligence will serve to be a smart assistant. Thanks for your patience listening. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. For the valuable and informative session, so some questions are there. So I will read out the questions for you.
Okay.
So first question is, when it